Okay, this is the real last one. Thanks again for coming.
I'm waiting for the train. Subway that only goes one way. The stupid thing will come and pull us apart.
Oh yeah, the biggest lie. Like White Lady Loves You More, it's a place where the themes of the record really come together. Whether he's playing a character or he's speaking for himself, it feels so intimate and naked and self-revealing, that song does. So it's another one that just like shakes me to the core. It's just so emotionally powerful.
For whatever reason, I don't know what it is. It doesn't have anything to do with Elliott personally, I don't believe, but that song will make me cry every time. And it's something about its construction, and it's something about its melody, and it's written kind of like a children's in the round. You know what I mean? Like where kids would sing a phrase and then the other kids would sing a phrase half off and it would match up. He would play with that type of construction, like Ring Around the Rosie. You could sing Ring Around the Rosie and then somebody else could start in. And there's something about The Biggest Lie that reminds me of that kind of song construction. It's not actually in the round, but it just like loops again and again and again. So it's just sort of this poignant phrasing, melodic phrasing that for whatever reason, I don't know if it's the notes or the timing, but whatever it is, it just hits me. It's a very emotional song for me.
You spend everything you had. Wanted everything to stop that bad. Now I'm a crushed credit card and registered to Smith. Not the name that you call me with.
If there's a thread like that in Elliott's lyrics, it's not a suicide thread as much as it is a resigned, that there's no pain-free existence, that pain is always there, you know? That don't kid yourself that tomorrow is going to be better kind of thing. And that's how I feel about this song.
And I remember even the first time I heard it when he was practicing it, I was like, ugh. There was something that was kind of scary to me about that song. And it was captured perfectly on tape. And I don't know, I've never talked to anybody else about it, about what they hear with that song or anything, but there's something about it. And I love it that it's the last song on the record too, because I remember the first time I heard it, there was something that I didn't like about it. It was just sort of a scary song to me. And it just makes me sad.
I mean, the most important thing he ever told me, I think, was I want to write songs. I want to record songs. Everything else is stuff I have to do that. So touring, interviews, signing contracts, whatever, you know, that's just the crap that you have to do the part he wanted to do. And he just wanted to keep getting really good songs, you know, writing really good songs and recording them. That's all that mattered. So I think when you look at it that way, the records thankfully hold up pretty well still, and they hold their own, and he got to do these. And I just wish we'd gotten to see a lot more of these records from him.
So can you imagine being a shy person having to do the Oscars against Celine Dion, and then right before you walk on stage, they hand you a suit that is made for a man 10 times your size? It was the most terrifying thing I've ever witnessed on TV. I remember Mom and I watched it, and we both screamed. We were like, what is he wearing? Why is he wearing? Because his hands, the suit arm length was too long for his hands. And I was like, oh my God. And it was like dressing a small child in a giant man suit. It was so mean. It was like the meanest thing that's ever happened on television. That was where I felt sorry for him and proud of him, but really scared for him. But also that was the first time that I really understood that, oh shit, like he's good. Like his music will be out in the universe forever and ever and ever. And that was a really good feeling to have. because you don't get that very often. You get, when you work with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of artists, the couple that get to have that shot and that chance that you care about and that you support is so rare. It's a super good feeling. Suit and all, but Jesus.
I think that, I don't know. I got a lot of thoughts. I don't know. I'm not blaming anyone in specific. It's just, you know, everyone's playing their part and doing what they think is right. But it's like, I don't think that being in Good Will Hunting or being nominated for an Oscar was good. I don't think that being on a major label was good. I think this sort of bullshit exposure that you get on something like the Oscars is just distracting. And I think that the major label thing, I mean, as far as I know, I remember one time a few years ago finding out that he still hadn't recouped on XO or something. And you're just like, what? Give me a fucking break. You know, that's a joke. If that had been on Kill Rock Stars with Slim, he would have made hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars from that release along with the label. And then you're telling me that XO didn't make any money at all. You know, I know there were advances, but advances are never that much compared to what goes on. And it's like, that just seems weird, you know? And I think that the world that he was thrust into, you know, Lenny Warnker and everybody kind of propped him up, or didn't prop him up, but they encouraged him to go into it. It wasn't the right world. You know, if this had been like the 70s and he was hanging out with Jackson Browne, it would have made sense. He would have been another top songwriter, and he and J.D. Souther could go hang on a porch somewhere and trade licks, you know? But this world that they tried to put him into, there wasn't even a category for a guy of this, of his abilities to exist in within the major label world. And he's not going to fit into a slot, you know. Oh, he's a songwriter, so he's going to just stand there and play acoustic guitar. Yeah, but also with a band sometimes, and he wants to put piano on it and layer the harmonies and strings. And, you know, I mean, it's just, I think a lot of things got handled wrong, and he wasn't always the most assertive person to just say, this is what I want, you know. He would try to just go along and keep other people happy as well. And I think sometimes that was the worst part of his personality.
Because then it went very fast. I mean, he was picked up very fast. He started making records like crazy. And DreamWorks, you know, got a hold of him pretty quick. I remember when I was in Texas and the first time he did a show in Texas on DreamWorks, that he contacted me and we were all excited to see each other. And then he's like, yeah, meet me afterwards. And when I went out, I actually had to stand in line. I had to stand in an autograph line in order to say hi to him. And it was just so surreal because I was like, this is really weird. And he's like, yeah, this is really, really weird. And he was on this giant tour bus alone.
God, you know, I mean, I think if there'd been a different path, it could have been a little easier and it could have been a little more in his control. One of the best quotes about that would certainly be from Joanna Balme. I think maybe it was in Autumn de Wilde's book, and she says something like, if you made him do things, if you made him work, he would work. And if you do everything for him, he's kind of aimless. So like, you know, having to say, Elliott, if you come help me build this studio, then you can work out of here. Okay, good, I'll do that. It just give him a lot of focus. And once he started getting, like, you know, tour managers, which you need tour managers. I get this. I'm not saying this is wrong. But you get all these people around you doing everything for you and people going, do you want a glass of water? You know, like, just, you know, I think some of it just ends up building this. It just sets people up for a different world perspective, everything. And I don't know. It's funny. I was just reading about Pink Floyd and The Wall, and there's so much of that in that story, you know, this sort of weird isolation and comfortably numb and all the weird rock star stuff. And, you know, I think that's kind of where he ended up, in a weird way, like sort of disconnected from himself, and it's just too fucking bad. I had very little contact with him. Like, I was going to go down and work on Basement on a Hill, and I talked to him on the phone a little bit before that, you know, a couple of weeks before he passed. So he just sounded different, you know, than he had been in the past. It was weird. It sounded weaker and different. It's weird. I hesitate to, I don't even really want to know what someone does to themselves to get there, you know.
Oh, we're so very precious, you and I. And everything that you do makes me wanna die. Oh, I just told the biggest lie. I just told the biggest lie.
I mean, nobody needs me to tell them that he really achieved a new level of maturity and sophistication in his songwriting and singing and guitar playing when he did this record. And like I was talking about before, the emotional directness. And I think that's why it's still a standout.
I think it was a really brave piece of work. And I'm glad that we were able to do it. And as anything, I don't think it could be reproduced any other way. I think it just was a perfect little room and a perfect little setup, really simple gear, and that it's the artistry of the artist that makes it a record that stays around rather than all everyone monkeying around with gear.
With self-titled, it's like the recording luckily doesn't get in the way. It doesn't necessarily help in some cases. It's a little noisy or scratchy or whatever, but it's like the songs are so damn good that it's its own little world. It just works. It's amazing. And what was amazing that he went on to do several more albums at that level, like boom, boom, boom in a row. And then the outtakes were nearly as good or better in some cases. So that's just bizarre, you know, this period, like 95, 96, it was just ridiculous how many songs he wrote as New Moon shows and Mike City Sons and Either Or and this album and the singles and comp tracks. I mean, it's ridiculous.
You know, some people say it's the purest work of his solo work. I just think it has more to do with the excitement about it. He was really excited to do some solo work. And then after he did it, I think it gave him a real focus of like, oh yeah, that's where my interest is.
Even compared to these other, his other records, his later ones that have so much more put into them, so much more ambitious in so many ways and really achieve greatness a lot of the time, there's still something to the directness and the purity of this record that I think comes from just a great confluence of his ability, his confidence in what he was doing, and the slightly better recording situation, but not too much better. And it just seems like all the things came together on the self-titled record.